टाइम हो गया। अस्सलाम वालेकुम एवरीवन, कैसे
वालेकुम अस्सलाम।
ऑल डूइंग गुड?
यस मैम।
क्यों आज एनर्जी लेवल्स इस वक्त भी बहुत सबके डाउन है? अभी तो द डे हैज जस्ट स्टार्टेड। एनी कॉमेंट सिंस यस्टरडेज लेक्चर? कोई आपको चीज समझ नहीं आई हो? कोई एनी डिफिकल्टी विच यू पीपल वर फेसिंग? कुछ देखा घर जाके कि नहीं? घर में तो खैर यू आर ऑलरेडी इन योर हाउसेस, बट कुछ देखा आफ्टर द लेक्चर्स वर ओवर? एनीवन?
यस
मैम।
कुछ समझ आया बेटा?
यस मैम, आ गई थी समझ।
आ गई थी समझ, बिकॉज दिस वॉज द इजिएस्ट थिंग विच वी हैव डन सिंस the day before yesterday. That was the easiest part. Now as we go
forward,
जी बेटा,
मैम आपने रिप्रोडक्शन करवाई थी बैक्टीरिया की?
नहीं बेटा, रिप्रोडक्शन बैक्टीरिया की करवाने की as such जरूरत नहीं है, because it just you just need to remember कि it divides by binary fission. One bacteria is going to become two, two is going to become four, and that is all you require regarding the reproduction of the bacteria. बाकी जब हम फर्दर लेक्चर्स पढ़ाएंगे आपको, तो उसमें एक ग्रोथ साइकिल पढ़ाएंगे बैक्टीरिया की, उसमें भी रिप्रोडक्शन नहीं है, उसमें भी बेसिकली वी आर गोइंग टू टेल यू कि कौन से फोर फेजेस हैं इन विच अ बैक्टीरिया पासेस थ्रू फ्रॉम टू इंक्रीज इन नंबर और व्हेन इट डाइज ऑफ। तो वो आपका बैक्टीरियल ग्रोथ कर्व एंड बैक्टीरियल ग्रोथ साइकिल जो है, दैट इज प्रोबेबली द थर्ड और द थर्ड चैप्टर और सो। सो वो आपके नेक्स्ट लेक्चर में या लेक्चर के बाद। ये स्क्रीन खत्म हो गई है। तो why कुछ confusion थी about the bacterial growth या reproduction के बारे में?
मैम उसके यही था कि आपने पढ़ाया या नहीं, क्योंकि आपने ना वो एक टेबल करवाया था ना।
हाँ, बस उसमें मैंने आपको सिर्फ यही एक्सप्लेन किया था कि अ सेल इज डिवाइडिंग टू, इट गोज थ्रू डिफरेंट फेजेस स्टेजेस एंड देन इट बिकम्स टू। So that is what you need to remember, that bacteria, they undergo binary fission. One is going to divide into two, two into four, and it's a very rapid reproductive cycle, as a result of which within a short time the bacteria, they can from one they can become thousands or even millions. And that is why it is important, and the importance of this fact is that ki jab ye infection produce kar rahe hote, that is how they increase in number and they persist within the infective focus. So can anybody tell me what was the first structures which we studied? They were the appendages. Kaun kaun se teen cheeze appendages mein aati hain?
Mam, flagella,
pili, and the third one was
mam capsule bhi to aate hain?
Capsule nahi aata. Capsule we'll do the capsule today, but appendages are something which is outside the cell. So all of these, although they are arising from the cell, they are separate structures. ठीक है, cell का cell wall के या cell envelope के structure में capsule आता है, appendages में नहीं आता। So what's the third one?
Mam, fimbriae.
Fimbriae. And what's the difference between a fimbriae and a pilus or pili? Fimbriae or
pili? Protein structures होते हैं.
Yes.
And fimbriae are just fine hair-like threads.
They are also protein in nature, beta.
Glycoprotein.
नहीं बेटा, बेसिक स्ट्रक्चरल डिफरेंस जरूर होगा, बट द बेसिक डिफरेंस बिटवीन द टू इज दैट the fimbria, they are hair-like structures which are all over the bacterial cell, and they are basically involved in attaching the bacteria to the various surfaces. Pili are, they are specialized structures. They would be fewer in number as compared to the fimbriae. They are going to be longer as compared to the fimbriae, and they have certain, and they are also important for the attachment, but they have certain characteristics. For example, they are good. Some of them, they will have a liking or affinity, which we call a liking, for the intestinal epithelial cell. So any bacteria which has a pili which loves the intestinal epithelium, it has certain characteristics because of which it can get attached to the intestinal epithelium. Then it is going to go and get attached to the urinary bladder and produce an infection. Similarly, certain other bacteria, for example, you must have heard the name of E. coli, very common. It is present in the intestines, and it, if all of them will not produce a disease, but all those E. coli which have a certain pili or pili which is having a certain characteristic, they are going to get attached to the intestinal epithelium. They will stay there and they will produce a disease. So basically, these are anchoring structures, and these anchoring structures are not going to be present on all types of bacteria. They are limited to certain bacteria, and those bacteria are then more able to produce a disease as compared to the others. So these were the three three organs which were included in the appendages: the flagella, then we had the fimbriae, and finally were the pili. So next thing which we need to study are the surface layer structures, and amongst the surface layer structures we have three structures. Number one is the glycocalyx. Glycocalyx is a coating of molecules which is present outside the cell wall. It is made up of sugars and proteins, or it can just have proteins, and some are protein in nature, some are sugars in nature. There are two types of glycocalyx, and these glycocalyx are basically, it's a term which is being used very loosely for a capsule or a slime layer. So in some books, you would find just a glycocalyx, which is referring to a capsule or a slime layer. At other times, these two terms, they are all inclusive, and the bigger term is the glycocalyx. The difference between the two is that in case of a capsule, it is an organized structure. It is tightly attached to the cell wall, and it is not easily removable from the cell. Whereas a slime layer, it's loosely organized. It's a structure which is just around the cell. Yes, Mera?
Ma'am, awaaz crack ho rahi hai. Awaaz theek nahi aa rahi.
A capsule is a highly organized structure. It is attached to the cell wall, whereas a slime layer, it's loosely organized and it's just around the cell wall. And if you want to remove it, it is easily removable. Both of them, they have the same function. They cause attachment of the bacteria, facilitate the attachment of the bacteria to the surfaces. They, because of their presence, the complement cannot reach the bacterial cell wall. So it cannot get attached to various structures on the cell wall, and therefore phagocytosis cannot take place. And then it also acts as a receptor, which is going to allow these bacteria to specifically attach to various structures in the human system. So this is the slime layer. As you can see, it is a loose structure which is around the cell wall, and it's a hazy structure which is going around it. Whereas a capsule, it is a more organized structure, and you can remove the slime layer by washing or by different chemicals, but you cannot remove the capsule. The capsule is very important as a diagnostic tool as well. Can anybody tell me the difference between a negative staining and a positive staining?
मैम जो स्टेन ले लेते हैं वो पॉजिटिव स्टेन होता है, जैसे कि क्रिस्टल हम निकल पड़े थे और जो नहीं
The basic difference between a positive and a negative stain is that the positive stain is going to stain the structures, and a negative stain is going to stain the background. Okay, and most of the capsules, they are visualized with the help of negative staining. This is the background, which is blackish or grayish in color, and these are the organisms which are showing the capsule around them. So what happens?
Can you repeat it?
Negative staining is when you are staining the background. Positive staining is when you are staining the structures. जैसे हमने कल gram staining पढ़ी थी. That was a positive staining procedure because we were staining the bacterial cell wall. If we are staining the background, उसकी significance ये है कि the background becomes darker in color or light colored structures through which the stain cannot pass through, they become highlighted. For example, in this picture, you can see these bacteria and ये आपको इसमें थोड़ा सा darker नजर आ रहे हैं, but they haven't taken up the stain. बैकग्राउंड आपको ग्रेश नजर आ रहा है और ये जो पक्का नजर आ रहे हैं इनके अगेंस्ट दिस क्लियर हेलो इज द कैप्सूल थ्रू विच द डाई कुड नॉट पेनिट्रेट सो इट बिकम्स डीमार्केटेड एंड दिस स्टेनिंग इज अ कैरेक्टरिस्टिक फीचर ऑफ अ नंबर ऑफ बैक्टीरिया और उसकी कैप्सूल की प्रेजेंस को इंडिकेट करता है एंड इफ एन ऑर्गेनिज्म इज अ कैप्सुलेटेड ऑर्गेनिज्म वी नो दैट इज इट इज गोइंग टू बी मोर रेजिस्टेंट टू ट्रीट एज कम्पेयर टू अ ऑर्गेनिज्म विच इज नॉन कैप्सुलेटेड Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Then there is another structure which we commonly see and which has become very, very important nowadays, and that is the biofilms. A biofilm, kya? Biofilm basically is going to form, it's again a sort of a capsule or a slime layer, and it basically forms on surfaces which are not normal. ज्यादातर यू विल सी देम इन पेशेंट्स जहाँ पे जिनकी कोई प्रोस्थेसिस हुई है कोई उनका आर्टिफिशियल वाल्व है आर्टिफिशियल लिम्ब लगा हुआ है इट बिकम्स अ सर्फेस ऑन विच बैक्टीरिया दे कैन प्रोड्यूस सॉर्ट ऑफ अ स्टिकी सा मटीरियल एंड दैट स्टिकी मटीरियल अलाउज द बैक्टीरिया टू गेट अटैच टू द सर्फेस जब ये अटैच हो जाते हैं एंड दे स्टार्ट डिवाइडिंग तो देन दिस स्टिकी सर्फेस फॉर्म्स अ कॉलोनी अराउंड देम और अ लेयर अराउंड देम विच डज नॉट allow the immune mechanism of that individual to penetrate. So they are very easily surviving in this environment. And they stick together, they start producing colonies or us colonies mein different types of other bacteria which are in that area, they can also come. And as a result of which it becomes a focus of infection. So whenever a biofilm is going to form, it is not only protective to the bacteria, it will harm the individual with the delayed wound healing. Because the antibiotics, the immune system, phagocytic cells, they cannot reach these bacteria and destroy them. And as a result of which, the infection becomes very difficult to treat and infective focus remains there for a long time. And most of these, as I said,
जो हमारे पास flesh-eating bacteria हैं, वो भी biofilms के through active हैं.
कौन से वाले bacteria बेटा? मैकेनिज्म जो है टॉक्सिन प्रोडक्शन एज अ रिजल्ट ऑफ विच उसके सारे वो आते हैं इफेक्ट्स आते हैं बेसिकली ये आपको वहां नजर आएंगे जहाँ पे पेशेंट के अंदर प्रोस्थीसिस हुआ हुआ किसी का आर्टिफिशियल सर्फेसिस के ऊपर ये ग्रो करते हैं दे जनरली आर नॉट गोइंग टू स्टिक टू नॉर्मल सेल सर्फेसिस सो इसलिए उसमें आपको नजर नहीं आएगा इसमें जॉइंट जिनकी रिप्लेसमेंट हुई हुई है हार्ट वाल्व की रिप्लेसमेंट हुई हुई है कोई कैथेटर किसी का यूरिनरी कैथेटर पड़ा हुआ है उन सिचुएशंस में दीज बायोफिल्म्स आर मोर कॉमनली सीन और फिर चूंकि इनकी कवरिंग है दे आर प्रोटेक्टेड सो दे आर डिफिकल्ट टू ट्रीट एज वेल Then we come to the bacterial cell wall. All those things were outside the cell wall. Now, the bacterial cell wall is made up of two structures. Number one is the cell wall itself, and then there is the cell membrane. And finally, if we add the glycocalyx also, this whole is known as the cell envelope. So the cytoplasm is covered by the cell membrane or the cytoplasmic membrane. And outside the cytoplasmic membrane, you will have the cell wall. And outside the cell wall will be the glycocalyx. Now, the cell wall is the most important structure of the bacteria, and that is responsible for not only the survival of the bacteria in various environments, but it also forms a barrier to the antibiotics which we are giving to a patient. And it encloses the cytoplasm. It's a unique structure which is composed of complex polysaccharide materials. There are two sugars in this. Number one is the N-acetylmuramic acid, and number two is the N-acetylglucosamine. And these are attached with each other through tetrapeptide bonds. And these bonds are made up of L amino acids or the D forms of amino acids. This cell wall is different in gram-positive and in gram-negative bacteria. And on the basis of this, they have different staining characteristics as we discussed yesterday. And the gram-positivity and gram-negativity is based on the difference of the cell wall in gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. The most important difference is that in case of gram-positive, it is about 40 layers thick. In case of gram-negative, it is just a single layer of peptidoglycan. So this is the structure which you need to remember. Over here, you have these two, N-acetylglucosamine and N-acetylmuramic acid. And then we have the tetrapeptide chains. This is the chain which is made up of the amino acids. And then this is the interbridge which is linking these two tetrapeptide chains. So over here, you have the glycan chain. Then you have the tetrapeptide. Then you have the interbridge. And finally, you have another tetrapeptide. And therefore, these two glycan chains, they are going to be linked to each other. So this is one layer. This is the second layer. And similarly, they are going to be multiple layers in case of gram-positive bacteria. Now, two amino acids are very important. Number one is the diaminopimelic acid because it is present only in the bacterial cells. And second is the D-alanine, and this is going to be present in this area. And this is the site of action of the penicillin antibiotic. Therefore, we need to remember this. Just to show you the thickness.
Gram-negative ke andar peptide interchange nahi na hoga.
Kya cheez beta? Gram-negative mein?
Peptide interbridge nahi hoga.
Usme beta is tarah se hoga ki aapka sirf ye number one and number two layer, this constitutes one layer. Ye sirf ek layer present hogi. In which there will be this tetrapeptide bondage. But isse agli layers, they will not be present. So this is just going to be, these two layers will constitute one peptidoglycan layer in a gram-negative organism. In gram-positive, they are going to be several layers. Now, this we've discussed that this is because of the peptidoglycan layer that the gram staining varies. What are the functions of the cell? Basically, it's a supportive structure which gives the shape to the bacteria. It maintains a rigid structure for the bacteria, which is not going to be harmed by the normal environment which it comes across. Then it provides strength to the bacteria in the form of preventing the rupture through osmosis. Because if the outer side, the osmotic pressure between the interior of the bacteria and the exterior is different, the integrity of the cell wall will prevent the fluid from going in or out, and it will therefore protect the cell. Then it carries the bacterial antigens, which are important in virulence as well as in immunity. And finally, this is the site of the activity of certain antibiotics, especially the penicillins and the cephalosporins. Now, just to give you an idea about how the cell wall grows. Basically, the sugars, that is the N-acetylglucosamine and N-acetylmuramic acid, they are synthesized in the cytoplasm. And then they have a carrier protein, which is known as lactoprenol. The pentapeptides and the sugars, they get attached to the lactoprenol. It carries it across the cytoplasmic membrane, and then it breaks up this bridge, that is the tetrapeptide bridge, and it inserts this unit over here. Excuse me. And this is with the help of certain enzymes like the transglycosidase enzyme. And this gets inserted over here, and as a result of which the cell starts, cell thickness and the cell wall gets it gets inserted into the cell wall, and you have an increasing thickness of the cell wall. These peptide bridges, they are going to be destroyed by the transpeptidase enzymes. Why are we interested in this? Because again, this becomes the site of action of penicillin. And also it is the site when the bacteria releases its enzymes, which are known as autolysins. Auto ka matlab hota hai self and lysins ka matlab hota hai destroy karne wali. So at times in a certain situation, the bacteria starts producing the autolysins due to certain environmental factors. Aur wo bhi is cell wall pe isi tarah se act karna shuru kar dete. Then we have an enzyme which is known as lysozyme, which is normally present in our body. It is present in the human tears, mucus, and saliva. And it can also break the peptidoglycan chain. And this is a natural resistance mechanism of ours against the bacterial infections. So in the tears, which is exposed to the environment, in the mucus, in the saliva, all of these, they are exposed to the outer environment. We have lysozyme, and as soon as the bacteria goes there, especially the gram-positive bacteria, they are going to have a peptidoglycan layer which is thick, and it starts destroying them. And when it gets destroyed, since the cell wall is no longer there, the bacteria is exposed and it can be easily destroyed. Lysozyme-treated bacteria, they can undergo two different end results. Number one is that it gets the cell wall broken. After the cell wall is broken, then there is the breakage of the cytoplasm, and as a result of which the cell is going to imbibe water. It is going to take up the water. The cell swells up and it has a higher internal osmotic pressure, and the cell bursts. So it gets destroyed. On the other hand, if the osmotic pressure of the interior of the cell, bacterial cell, is the same as that of the extracellular environment, then it will take up the water, but it will not be destroyed because the osmotic pressure inside is not going to be greater than the outside. So with an equal osmotic pressure, it will take up the water, it will swell up, it will become a spherical form, and that is known as a protoplast. And protoplasts are important. Why? Because they are being used in a number of genetic studies. They are utilizing these forms to study various types of genetic factors and for genetic manipulation to produce new genes. Now, this is a gram-positive cell wall. The most important structure, apart from the peptidoglycan layer, which is this, is the teichoic acid. And this teichoic acid is attached to the muriatic acid portion of the peptidoglycan layer. So you will have two types of teichoic acid. Number one is basically the teichoic acid, which is going from the outside into the peptidoglycan layer. And number two is one which is going to go right deep into the cytoplasmic membrane. And into the cytoplasmic membrane, it gets attached to the lipid portion of the cytoplasmic membrane. And these are known as the lipoteichoic acid. Basically, these are chains of ribitol phosphate or glycerol phosphate, and they have various sugars or alanines attached to them. And depending upon the type of bacteria which we are dealing with, there will be a difference in the sugars and the amino acids which constitute the teichoic acid. But for your purpose, you just need to remember that these are chains of ribitol phosphate or glycerol phosphate, and they have sugars or amino acids or alanine attached to it. What's the function of the teichoic acid? Number one, it is the antigenic determinant. Antigenic determinant, do you understand what is meant by the term antigenic determinant? Anybody? Okay. Antigenic determinant is that area of a bacteria which is going to stimulate the production of antibodies. So it basically becomes the structure which is going to...
Ma'am, wo bacteria ka defense mechanism?
Defense mechanism bhi ban jata hai bacteria ka, because it is going to be destroying the cells which are around us. Theek hai na? So body is going to make the antibodies against that antigenic determinant, but by the time it is going to make that antibodies, us waqt tak wo अपनी इसी फोकस को इसी पॉइंट को यूज करते इट कैन कॉज अ लॉट ऑफ डैमेज इन द बॉडी. नंबर टू, टिकोइक एसिड इज पार्टिसिपेटिंग इन द सप्लाई ऑफ मैग्नीशियम टू द सेल बाय बाइंडिंग विद द मैग्नीशियम आयंस. सो इंटरनली वो इंटरनल ट्रांसपोर्टेशन इनटू द साइटोप्लाज्म इज विद द हेल्प ऑफ द टिकोइक एसिड. देन इट ऑल्सो रेगुलेट्स द नॉर्मल सेल डिविजन. एंड नॉर्मली आपकी जो टिकोइक एसिड है इसके अंदर शुगर्स होते हैं एंड प्रोटीन इज फाउंड ओनली इन सम बैक्टीरिया. For example, the streptococci. What's the medical importance of tichoic acid? Basically, it is inducing inflammation and septic shock. And therefore, it is going to activate the same pathways as the gram-negative bacteria. Although those structures shock ke pathway ko ya inflammation ke pathway ko activate karte hain gram-negative bacteria mein, they are not present in the gram-positive. Unki jagah, tichoic acid is acting as the same. When we discuss the gram-negative, you will understand that the gram-negative bacteria, the outer wall, that is different from the gram-positive, and it is made up of a lipopolysaccharide layer. A lipopolysaccharide layer, it is an endotoxin. Endotoxin, why? Because it induces inflammation, it causes septic shock. Exotoxin or endotoxin, ki differences aap logon ne padhe mein?
No, ma'am.
Basically, we are going to study the host defenses, we are going to give you the differences between endotoxin and exotoxin. Just for this time, just remember that exotoxin is something which is secreted. Chahe wo gram-positive bacteria ho, chahe gram-negative bacteria ho, it is actively secreting a certain substance, a toxin, into the environment. And because it is being secreted, it is called an exotoxin. On the other hand, certain bacteria, जैसे ग्राम नेगेटिव बैक्टीरिया उनका स्ट्रक्चर जो है उसके अंदर सर्टेन कंपोनेंट्स हैं जो कि इन्फ्लेमेशन और सेप्टिक शॉक को इंड्यूस कर सकते हैं सो इट डज नॉट नीड टू बी सिक्रीटेड इनटू द एनवायरनमेंट टू प्रोड्यूस द सेम इफेक्ट वो जो कंपोनेंट है उसका एंडो लाइपोपॉलीसेक्राइड वो एक्ट करता है एज अ टॉक्सिन सो देयरफॉर एज इट इज ए पार्ट ऑफ द सेल इट इज कॉल्ड एन एंडोटॉक्सिन वो चूंकि सिक्रीट होते हैं दे आर कॉल्ड एक्सोटॉक्सिन सो दिस इज द बेसिक डिफरेंस यू नीड टू रिमेंबर एट दिस पॉइंट ग्राम नेगेटिव बैक्टीरिया में टिकोइक एसिड नहीं होता बट ग्राम पॉजिटिव में टिकोइक एसिड है ग्राम नेगेटिव में लाइपोपॉलीसेक्राइड इन बोथ ऑफ देम दे हैव द सेम फंक्शन एंड टिकोइक एसिड इज आल्सो गोइंग टू हेल्प इन द अटैचमेंट टू द म्यूकोसल सेल नाउ दिस इज द ग्राम नेगेटिव सेल वॉल ओवर हियर यू हैव द साइटोप्लाज्मिक मेम्ब्रेन देन यू हैव अ स्पेस एंड देन यू हैव द आउटर मेम्ब्रेन अब ये आउटर मेम्ब्रेन इज अ कंपोनेंट ऑफ a few structures and this separates the cytoplasmic membrane from the outer layer. Ab yahan pe sirf ek layer hai of peptidoglycan. Otherwise, the thickness of the gram negative cell wall is because of the outer membrane, which is towards the exterior of the cell. This outer membrane is made up of different structures. Number one is the porine. These are channels which are going to allow the passage of certain molecules from the exterior towards the interior of the cell. And they go right down to the cytoplasmic. From here, then it goes into the periplasmic space. Or then once it can be transported across the cytoplasmic membrane. Outer membrane is going to be anchored to the peptidoglycan layer through the lipoproteins. So we have lipid portion of the outer membrane and the protein portion, which is going to be attaching the outer membrane to the peptidoglycan layer. Most of the gram-negative organisms, they have a space between the cytoplasmic membrane and the outer membrane. Rather, all of the gram-negative, they have the space which is known as the periplasm. And this periplasmic space has a number of enzymes. They have a number of other important structures, toxins, etc., which are responsible for, which are going to help the gram-negative cell wall in producing a disease. Then, this is the last and the most important structure of the outer membrane, which is the lipopolysaccharide. And this is going to go into the extracellular space. So, it's just like a sort of a filament, which is anchored to the outer membrane from one end, and it has three ends, which are in the exterior. As I told you, it's a space, periplasmic space is the space between the inner and the outer membranes of the gram-negative bacteria. It contains the peptidoglycan layer and a number of other enzymes, as well as proteins. And then it also has certain enzymes like the beta-lactamase. Then we have the ESBL enzymes. All of them, they are enzymes which are going to destroy certain structures which are not helpful for the survival of the bacteria. For example, if we are giving an antibiotic like penicillin, if the bacteria is producing this enzyme beta-lactamase, it is going to destroy the penicillin. If the penicillin is destroyed, the bacteria is able to survive. So coming to the lipopolysaccharide, it is made up of three structures, three components. Number one is the lipid A. And lipid A is responsible for the toxicity of this whole structure. And lipid A is the endotoxin of the gram-negative bacteria. Please remember that LPS is made up of three structures, but it is only the lipid A which is responsible for the endotoxin activity of the bacteria. It is made up of disaccharide, diphosphate, as well as fatty acids. Then we have the core, which is made up of polysaccharides. And these are basically five sugars which are linking the lipid A to the O antigen. And finally, we have the repeating subunits of a specific polysaccharide, which is also known as the O antigen. And in this case, the length is going to vary in different bacteria, but approximately they are about 25 units consisting of 3 to 5 sugars. And they are the same which are being repeated, and they will make the whole length of this O antigen, which is in the exterior, which is freely mobile. And this becomes the antigenic determinant of the gram-negative bacteria. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, what are the functions of the LPS? As I told you, it acts as an endotoxin. It's a part of the cell walls, therefore we are calling it as an endotoxin. It induces fever and shock. Then it acts, the O antigen of the LPS, it acts as the virulence factor because it is going to elicit the immune response. And another important thing about this O side chain of the LPS is that it is able to change its shape. It is able to change its antigenic nature. And when it changes the antigenic nature, iska kya fayda hoga antigenic nature ko change karne ka? What is going to be the benefit to the bacteria? If it changes, for example, antigenic nature, humne identify kiya ki it is A. And after some time, we find it has changed into B. So what is it going to help?
ज़्यादा देर तक अपना डिफेंस मैकेनिज्म चेंज कर सकता है, जिसकी वजह से वो बॉडी के अंदर ज़्यादा स्टे कर सकता है, डिस्ट्रॉय नहीं होगा।
Because अगर आपका इम्यून मैकेनिज्म स्टिमुलेट हो गया, for example by the A antigen, then the antibodies would be directed against the A. But if the bacteria changes over a period of time, if it changes the antigenic structure to a slight extent and now it becomes B and no longer A, तो वो जो A के अगेंस्ट एंटीबॉडीज बनी हैं, वो तो उसके साथ अटैच नहीं होंगे. So the bacteria is then going to be able to survive. Then again, it acts as an adhesion molecule. It allows it to attach to the surfaces, and gram-negative bacteria are more commonly involved in biofilm formation. And then it also acts as a permeability barrier, resulting in preventing the antibiotics, other toxic substances from going into the cell wall. Clear up to this point, G?
Bacteria apni antigen change kaise karte hain?
Beta, bacterial antigen change karte hain through their genes. Kyunki genes hi wo antigens are basically protein in nature. Aur bacteria ki jo genes hain wo specific proteins ko manufacture kar rahi hoti hain. But under certain circumstances, जो आपके environmental influences भी होते हैं, for example, एक bacteria को बहुत अरसे के लिए एक antibiotic के solution में डाले रखोगे, तो उसकी genes जो हैं, वो mutate कर जाएंगे, और फिर वो एक time आएगा कि वो जो antibiotic solution है, वो उसको affect नहीं करेगा, ठीक है? So it's basically the nature, the proteins which constitute the antigenic component, वो उसकी change हो जाएंगे, जैसे इसके अंदर आपके जो side chains में आपके जो sugars हैं. यहाँ पे रिपीटिंग शुगर्स है ना, ये रिपीटिंग शुगर्स का जो इसका कॉम्पोनेंट है, अगर बिल्फर्स ये 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 का कॉम्पोनेंट था, द बैक्टीरिया इज गोइंग टू चेंज इट इनटू 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. इस तरह से वो उसकी शुगर की जो शुगर की सिंथेसिस है उसको चेंज कर देगा, तो उसका एंटीजेनिक स्ट्रक्चर चेंज हो जाएगा. द सेम थिंग हैपेंस जो हमारा अब आपको कॉमनली आपने देखा होगा, फ्लू जो है वो हर साल उसकी वेरिएशन हो जाती है. अभी आप कोविड में सुन रहे हो कि उसकी वेरिएंट्स निकल गए. इट इज बेसिकली बिकॉज दे आर अंडरगोइंग म्यूटेशन एंड दे आर प्रोड्यूसिंग न्यू टाइप्स ऑफ एंटीजेंस व्हिच आर नॉट प्रेजेंट बिफोर. सो जो आपकी वैक्सीन है वो उसके अगेंस्ट इफेक्टिव नहीं हो रहे। ठीक है
मैम, इसी मैकेनिज्म से ये एंटीबायोटिक रेजिस्टेंस प्रोड्यूस करता है।
ऑफ कोर्स इसी मैकेनिज्म से एंटीबायोटिक रेजिस्टेंस प्रोड्यूस करते हैं, बट एंटीबायोटिक रेजिस्टेंस के मल्टीपल फैक्टर्स हैं, दिस इज वन ऑफ देम। ठीक है
ओके थैंक
यू। नाउ हाउ डू द मॉलिक्यूल्स दे पास थ्रू दिस सेल वॉल। अब ग्राम पॉजिटिव में तो वो दे कैन पास थ्रू द पोर्स इन द पेप्टाइडोग्लाइकन लेयर। अब यहां पे ग्राम नेगेटिव में पोरिंस हैं व्हिच आर चैनल्स थ्रू व्हिच पास थ्रू फ्रॉम द आउटर मेम्ब्रेन इनटू द पेरिप्लाज्मिक स्पेस, और इसमें से मॉलिक्यूल्स व्हिच आर लेस देन 700 डाल्टन्स इन साइज दे कैन इजीली पास थ्रू। अब इसके अंदर से सर्टेन एंटीबायोटिक्स कैन आल्सो पास, एंड वंस दे पास थ्रू द पोरिन चैनल्स दे कैन गो इनटू द पेरिप्लाज्मिक स्पेस, और पेरिप्लाज्मिक स्पेस से देन दे कैन डिस्ट्रॉय द स्ट्रक्चर्स ओवर हियर, दे कैन डिस्ट्रॉय द साइटोप्लाज्मिक मेम्ब्रेन। और वो and who antibiotics which are able to pass through these and go inside, they are going to cause the destruction of the bacteria, and in that case we say ki the antibiotic ko ye bacteria antibiotic ko sensitive hai. Lekin again if there is a change in the structure of this porine because of a mutation, that antibiotic will not be able to pass through, uska size chota ho jata hai, or it forms some other barrier to that antibiotic, so then it will not be able to go inside, and at that stage we will say ki antibiotic resistance has developed against that particular antibiotic. Clear? Now these are the basic differences between the gram positive and the gram negative cell wall. Peptidoglycan we've discussed, it thinner in a gram negative cell wall. Ticoic acid is not present. Lipoticoic acid is not present. Periplasmic space is absent in case of a gram positive cell wall, and whereas in case of gram negative it contains the enzymes for transportation, degradation, synthesis and antibiotic resistance. Then the outer membrane is present in a gram negative, and we have a lipopolysaccharide, especially the lipid A component, which is the endotoxin. You need to remember these differences because they are an SCQ question and we're commonly asked question. Then we move on to the cytoplasmic membrane. Cytoplasmic membrane is a thin layer, about 5 to 10 millimeters in nanometers in size, and it is going to be the separation between the cytoplasm and the cell wall. It's a semi-permeable membrane which is made up of phospholipid components. The phospholipid, the phosphate component is towards the outside, and the lipid component is towards the interior. This is water soluble, and this is water insoluble. And as it is a semi-permeable membrane, it will allow the metabolites to move through it, go in both directions. What are the functions of the cytoplasmic membrane? Number one, as we've discussed, selective permeability, allowing some substances to pass through and others will not be able to pass through because of their size. Then certain substances can be actively transported through the cytoplasmic membrane with the help of enzymes. As we discussed, lactoprenol carrier, and from the point where it leaves it at the cytoplasmic membrane, we have other enzymes like the permease enzyme, which will allow the substances to pass through the cytoplasmic membrane. It's a site for energy production. It's a site where the toxins and the enzymes are going to be excreted from. It is the site where other proteins and the structures which are required by the cell wall, they are going to be synthesized, like we've discussed the peptidoglycan layer synthesis. And it is also an important site for DNA chromosomal attachment and the beginning of the division of the bacteria. Cytoplasm itself is 80% water, 20% is made up of salts, proteins, various types of proteins. It has nucleic acids, it has ions, carbohydrates, whatever it requires for its growth and multiplication. DNA is present within the cytoplasm. It's a circular stranded, it's a circular strand, single strand. It also has certain extracellular DNA material, which are known as plasmids. Then it has ribosomes for protein synthesis, but it does not have any mitochondrial Golgi apparatus, which is present in the eukaryotic cells. So let's study the bacterial chromosome. Simple structure. This is a single, large, circular, double-stranded DNA, not like the eukaryotic DNA. And basically, it's super coiled on each on itself so that it can be accommodated within the small bacterial cell. The only proteins which are associated with it are those which are responsible for its replication, which are important for its transcription, that is for its duplication. Then apart from the bacterial DNA, we have certain extra chromosomal structures which are known as plasmids. Ab ye extra chromosomal isliye keh rahe hain because they are not part of the original DNA. They are there and they can move from one bacterial cell to another as well. They are smaller in structure, they are double-stranded, and they are capable of multiplying or replicating. Not multiplying, of replicating. Bacterial DNA bhi replicate kar sakta hai, but iski bacterial DNA bhi replicate karega, but plasmids can also replicate independently of the bacterial DNA. So it's not necessary ki jab bacterial DNA replicate kar raha hai, to plasmids replicate kare. Even in the resting state, these plasmids, they are able to replicate. Another important factor is that ye plasmids jo hain, during bacterial DNA replication, they can get attached over here. So, importance is ki ye hai ki plasmids carry certain genes. Isme antibiotic resistance genes bhi aa jati hain, and resistance to a certain chemical ki genes bhi aa jati hain. A lot of genes can be carried on the plasmids depending on their type. Aur jo bhi gene is bacterial DNA ke andar incorporate ho jayegi, wo bacterial DNA ka hissa ban jayegi. Jab wo hissa ban jayegi, to when this is going to have certain characteristics, तो जो कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स इस जीन के पास से आई है वो भी इस बैक्टीरिया का एक कैरेक्टरिस्टिक फॉर्म बन जाएगा. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, इफ यू हैव अ प्लाज्मिड व्हिच इज कोडिंग फॉर द इसके लिए कोड कर रहा है, लेट्स से पेनिसिलिन की रेजिस्टेंस के लिए कोड कर रहा है, तो वंस इट इज कोडिंग फॉर द पेनिसिलिन रेजिस्टेंस, और ये नॉर्मल बैक्टीरियल डीएनए में कोई पेनिसिलिन रेजिस्टेंस की जीन नहीं है, देन वॉट इज गोइंग टू हैपन कि जब during multiplication replication of bacterial DNA, ये gene इसमें integrate हो जाएगी. तो जब ये अपनी proteins बनाएगी, अपनी characteristics को express करेगी, तो ये antibiotic resistance to penicillin को भी express करेगी. So a bacterial DNA, a bacteria which was initially sensitive to the penicillin, after acquiring a gene from this plasmid which carried the antibiotic resistance for penicillin, नाउ इसकी जितनी भी पॉपुलेशन बनेगी, जितनी भी इसकी प्रोजेनी डॉटर सेल्स बनेंगे, उन सब के अंदर वो जीन होगी जो कि एंटीबायोटिक रेजिस्टेंस टू पेनिसिलिन होगी. सो फ्रॉम वन मदर बैक्टीरिया व्हिच वाज सेंसिटिव टू पेनिसिलिन, आफ्टर द एक्विजिशन ऑफ द जीन फ्रॉम दिस प्लाज्मिड, जितने भी डॉटर सेल्स बन गए, दे विल बी रेजिस्टेंट टू द पेनिसिलिन. सो इस तरह से बैक्टीरियल रेजिस्टेंस डेवलप हो जाती है. And this plasmid is going to be present in both the gram positive and gram negative bacteria. Clear? Ye point clear hai?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, plasmids can be of two types: transmissible or non-transmissible. Transmissible ka matlab, it's an English word. Transmissible means ki it can be transferred from one cell to the other. Specific mechanism hota hai transfer ka, jo conjugation kehlata hai. ठीक है? They ट्रांसमिसिबल प्लाज्मिड्स का साइज हमेशा बड़ा होता है बिकॉज दे कंटेन अ लार्ज नंबर ऑफ जीन्स विच आर रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर डिफरेंट कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स, लाइक के पिलाई की फॉर्मेशन के लिए, एंजाइम्स की फॉर्मेशन के लिए, जो कि ट्रांसफर करते हैं फ्रॉम वन कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स फ्रॉम वन बैक्टीरिया टू द अदर, देन दे फॉर द एंटीबायोटिक रेजिस्टेंस, एंड दे आर यूजली प्रेजेंट इन अ फ्यू नंबर. ऑल्दो दे आर लार्ज, लेकिन उनकी कॉपीज एक या तीन से ज्यादा नहीं होती. ऑन द अदर हैंड, नॉन ट्रांसमिसिबल, which means they cannot be transferred from one bacteria to another, they are smaller in size, but they are greater in number in each cell. They do not contain the transfer genes. Ye apne characteristics jo hai, wo ek bacteria se dusre bacteria mein transfer nahi kar sakte. The only thing which they can do is that ki usi bacteria ke andar koi aisi gene apni jo hai wo usme insert karte hain bacterial chromosome mein, aur wo characteristic fir us bacteria ke andar apparent होनी शुरू हो जाएगी. But in case of transmissible plasmids, it can go from A bacteria to a B bacteria to a C bacteria to a D bacteria. और फिर जितनी भी populations होगी A, B, C, D की, वो सबके सब वो characteristic carry करेगी. Non-transmissible में अगर वो A में मौजूद है, तो it will stay in A, और only A की characteristics जो उसकी daughter cells में आएंगी, और किसी में नहीं. Now, which are the characteristics which these plasmids they can be transferring. Number one is the antibiotic resistance, as I've just explained to you. और ये antibiotic resistance different mechanism से हो सकती है. They can code for a gene which is allowing the organism to produce an enzyme जो कि penicillin जो कि antibiotic को break up कर देता है. Yeah, they can code for a gene which is going to cause the changes in the permeability of the membrane. Yeah, porins ke upar effect karte the. So different mechanisms which are going to result in antibiotic resistance. Number two, they can code for genes which are causing the production of exotoxins. We discussed exotoxins. Exotoxins wo hain jo ke synthesize hote hain by the bacteria and they are released into the environment. So if the plasmid carries a gene, ek bacteria hai jo ki exotoxin produce nahi karta, but agar uske andar uski bacterial chromosome mein plasmid insert ho jata hai jiski gene toxin production ko promote karti, so then that bacteria will change from one which is not producing an exotoxin to another one which is producing an exotoxin. Hit it will code for the pili formation. Pili ki jo hai formation jab wo code karega to this is going to help in the adherence of the bacteria to the epithelial cells. Hit certain genes which are going to cause resistance in the bacteria to ultraviolet light, to heavy metals such as mercury and silver. And in sab cheezon ke mechanism ka, in sab resistance factors ke end result kya hai? It is providing an environment to the bacteria or making it more stronger against any factor which is going to kill the bacteria. Then it also produces bacteriocin genes which are going to result in the production of bacteriocins, and these are also proteins which are toxic for other bacteria. Okay, aap itna yaad kar lo ki ye bacteriocins jo hain they are toxins which are induced by the plasmids. Plasmid ki genes jo hain jab ek attach ho jayenge to wo bacteria certain toxins produce karna shuru kar dega jinko bacteriocins kehlate hain, and bacteriocins jo hain they are going to be responsible for destruction of other bacteria. They are not going to be effective against the antibiotics, they are not going to be effective against the human koi tissues ke against. Ye basically ek bacteria produce kar raha hai aur jab hum isko dusre bacteria ke upar apply karte hain to it is going to cause the degradation of the bacterial cell membranes. Uske andar wo pores produce kar dete hai, uski cell membrane ko destroy kar dete hai, so bacteria is going to die. Similarly it can cause the destruction of the bacterial DNA. Both mechanisms are going to result in the death of the bacteria. And ye important factor jo hai we make use in our treatment of patients against certain bacteria. For example yahan pe E. coli ka maine example diya hua hai jo ki ek toxin produce karta hai jisko hum colocins kehte hain. The colocins ka jo hai this is going to act on the E. coli aur wo phir usko destroy karte hain. Similar to the antibiotics, bacteria ko target kar rahe hain, similarly it is a form of an anti it's a form of a toxin which is going to kill the bacteria. Then another term which you need to be familiar with are transposons. Transposons are again small pieces of DNA aur isme ye hai ki they can move between the DNA of bacteria, plasmids and bacteriophages. Bacteriophages, if you remember kal maine aapko bataya tha, these are viruses which infect the bacteria. Transposons mein it's not the same as a plasmid. Plasmid jo hai wo ek entity hai by itself. Transposons are just small pieces of DNA, and these small pieces of DNA agar wo aapke environment pe pade hain to they can get integrated into the DNA of the bacteria, they can get integrated into the DNA of the plasmids or the bacteriophages. Because they can move in the chromosome from one side to the other, they are also known as the jumping genes. And they can code for drug resistance, antibiotic resistance, they can code for the production of toxins, they can code for the production of various metabolic enzymes. Whenever they get attached to the chromosome of a bacteria or a plasmid, they are going to cause mutations in that bacteria or plasmid, and therefore they are going to affect the genes which are on their either side. So apart from producing the effect which they are carrying the gene for example drug resistance ki gene to wo carry kar rahe hain, to wo bacteria jo hai wo drug ke against resistance ho jayega, but at the same time because they are inserted into the bacterial chromosome to jo unke sides pe bacterial chromosome ke genes honge usko bhi wo change kar sakta hai, so the bacteria may have certain newer characteristics. Clear up to this point? Any questions?
Yes, ma'am.
Then we go on to the next structure, which is the mesosome. A mesosome is just an invagination of the plasma membrane, the cytoplasmic membrane. It does not have any shape. It forms it has a greater surface area, as a result of which it is a very important structure which allows the bacteria to take up nutrition, and it's an area for more transport of the material into the interior of the cytoplasm. Also, it becomes the site where the chromosome can get attached and the DNA replication can take place. And subsequently, the bacterial reproduction can take place. Then we have the ribosomes within the cytoplasm, and they are 60% RNA, 40% are the proteins. They have two subunits. Number one is the large one, number two is the second one, or the smaller one. And prokaryotes have an ATS, whereas the prokaryotes have a 70S and the eukaryotes have an 80S. And this is an important characteristic which allows us to make antibiotics which are targeting the ribosome in the bacteria. So if we make an antibiotic which is going to target the 70S ribosome, then it is not going to have any harmful effects against the human cells. And these are also the sites of protein synthesis. All bacterial cells are going to have ribosomes. Then there are certain inclusions, there are certain granules which are present within the cytoplasm. They generally do not have a distinct cell membrane around them. They are storage bodies. They can contain gas, they can contain glycogen, they can contain hydroxybutyric acid, they can contain anything which the bacteria needs for its survival. Their number is variable, the size is variable, the content is variable, and whenever their environmental sources are depleted, whenever the bacteria cannot take up nutrition from the environment, it is going to utilize these inclusion granules, these inclusion bodies, these substructures for its survival and for its nutrition. Then we come, this completes the whole of the bacterial structure as it is, or the bacterial components which make up the bacterial cell. Then there are specialized structure of the bacteria which will allow it to survive the adverse conditions. And these are known as the spores. And these spores, they are going to be made up of an interior which contains the DNA material. And then there are several layers around it, which are the protective layers which are going to allow it to survive in the adverse conditions. So they are going to be resistant to heat, to radiation, to cold, to boiling for more than 1 hour. If you boil them for these spores for more than 1 hour, even then they are not going to die off. They can survive in the dry conditions, in the mud for many, many years. And this is basically maybe because of an amino, they have many sulfur containing amino acids. And they can remain dormant for hundreds of years. One important amino acid is the diaminopimelic acid, which is responsible for the hardness or the survival of the bacteria of these endospores. The interior, this is known as the endospore, and the whole of it is known as the spore, and it can remain dormant, or not all bacteria are going to produce the spores. Basically, it is the basically it is the bacilli which are going to produce the spores. And in this, there are various categories like the Clostridia, Bacillus species, and a few others which are going to produce these spores. And when we know that the bacteria which is spore forming, then we are going to look for these which are going to be destructive or for the formation of these spores. Because until and unless we get rid of the spores, we are not going to get rid of the infection. Spores not only help us in identifying a particular bacteria, but they're also going to help us in identifying the various species of the bacteria because of their location. They have a small water, high calcium, and typical folic acid content, and this content makes it very resistant to different types of environmental factors. A common example of the spores is this species, which is Bacillus stereothermophilus. Thermophilus because it is heat loving, and they can survive in large in higher temperatures, but they are also utilized for the checking of the sterility of the equipment, of the when we are sterilizing our operation theaters, for all the instruments and the materials which are utilized for surgery. We are going to put these spores in the materials which we are going to sterilize, and afterwards we check whether these spores, they are alive or not. If the spores have died, that means the equipment or the gauze or the gowns which are being utilized in the theater, they are also completely free of bacteria as well as spores. Again, another example is of Bacillus anthracis. The spores of this were used as a biological warfare. Anthrax, the scare about a couple of years back, occurred in Jabbo, Twin Towers incident to Waka. So then Americans, they became very, very careful about biological warfare. And they were checking even their envelopes, their letters, for the presence of Bacillus anthracis, because they suppose agar aapke environment mein chale jaate, so they are going to just germinate. And once they germinate, they can be inhaled and produce inhalational pneumonia. And once a person, even if there is a single person jisne Bacillus anthracis ki wajah se pneumonia develop kar liya, then he can give that infection to a number of individuals, jaise aajkal COVID mein ho raha hai. So similarly, it's a airborne disease which could be spread to a wide number of individuals. Kindly stop this. So we were talking about the shape and the position of the bacterial spores. And this is just to give you an idea that there are different shapes, there are different sites. And depending upon the site and the shape, we are going to characterize the bacteria. And when we study Clostridium, we'll study this in detail. Now, there are two cycles, vegetative and the sporulative cycle. And from the vegetative cycle, it can go into the sporulation cycle and vice versa. Whenever the conditions are adverse, it will change from this into the spores. And whenever the spores find that the environment is conducive for the vegetative cell, it can go back into the, when the nutrition is adequate, it can go back to forming a vegetative cell. These are the various steps of formation. From the vegetative cell, first you will have a four spore, which will separate itself from the mother cell. And then the mother cell is going to engulf the four spore, and the chromosome is going to disintegrate, and this structure is the only one which is going to survive, and the rest of the mother cell is going to form the various coatings around the spore, and then finally the mother cell is going to die off and the endospore is going to be formed. This is a Gram staining, or it's a special stain which is showing you the spores which are present in these bacilli. Over here you can see these different spores. What is the medical importance of the spores? One, we've already discussed that medical supplies must be heated to 121 degrees centigrade for at least 15 minutes to kill the spores. Wounds which are contaminated with soil, they can be infected with spores. And once the spore goes into the tissue, over there it will find anaerobic, it will find conditions, it will find the nutrition, it will find the environment which is conducive for it to change itself into a vegetative form. And then it can produce a disease. Antibiotics are not going to be effective against these spores. They are going to be effective against only the vegetative forms of the bacteria. And spores, when we are going for a lab diagnosis, when, for example, from a wound, we are taking out a tissue and examining it under the microscope, we will not find the spores, but we will find the bacteria. Why? Because of the adequate nutrition, all the spores, they have changed themselves into the vegetative form, or which is growing in that environment, and we are not able to find the spores at the site of the infection. Very rarely we will find the spores. A few words about pleomorphism. It's a term which shows a variation in size and shape. Then involution forms. These are the forms which are not normal. They are present in cultures which are old. They are present in cultures which are in an environment which has a high salt concentration, and they cause a defective cell wall, and as a result of which they are going to either be swollen, they will have a different shape, and they are going to result in defective cell wall synthesis as well. Then there are different types of bacteria which are going to be different chemically because of the differences in the cell wall, like the rickettsia, chlamydia, mycoplasma. And these we will study in detail when we are studying these bacteria in special bacteriology. As I told you before, flowcharts are useful. You need to try to learn them. For example, this flowchart is giving you the classification of the bacteria into gram positive, gram negative, then into the rods and the cocci, then whether they require oxygen or they are going to grow in the absence of oxygen, then finally whether they are spore formers or not. So in this way, it becomes very easy for you to remember also the characteristics of a particular organism if you remember it through a flowchart. Any questions? You get a number of MCQs from the bacterial anatomy portion as well. So study this. If you have any questions, you can ask me, and I will try to answer to the best of my ability, and the forum is open. Jeevita.
जो bacteria होता है उसके glycocalyx layer और capsule दोनों होते हैं या कोई एक चीज होती है?
नहीं, दोनों में से एक होता है.
ठीक है, thank you.
दोनों में से एक होता है. Basically, जो कुछ bacteria जो हैं, they are going to have a capsule. They will not have a slime layer. But most of the bacteria, they will have a slime layer जिनके पास capsule नहीं होता. So either of the two are going to be present.
Ma'am, gram-negative bacteria जो होते हैं, वो envelope बनाता है. तो gram-positive bacteria का भी envelope होगा.
बेटा envelope तो जो है, that is a component of the capsule, cell wall and cytoplasmic membrane. ठीक है ना? So these three structures are present in both gram-positive and gram-negative. वो तो एक term है, जो कि तीनों चीजों को combine करके तो आपने एक term दे दिया कि जी cytoplasm, cell wall और capsule. Whether it is present or not. तो अगर capsule भी present है तो वो cell envelope बन जाता है. अगर capsule नहीं absent है तो even then the cell wall and the cytoplasm make up the cell envelope. दोनों में होगा.
Okay.
Basically, cell envelope is a term which is including these three components. ठीक है ना? इसलिए इसको हम सेल एनवेलप कहते हैं, एंड इट इज प्रेजेंट इन बोथ ग्राम पॉजिटिव एंड ग्राम नेगेटिव बैक्टीरिया, क्योंकि कैप्सूल इज प्रेजेंट बोथ इन ग्राम पॉजिटिव एज वेल एज इन ग्राम नेगेटिव बैक्टीरिया. एनी अदर क्वेश्चन? ओके, थैंक यू बेटा. एंड यू कैन इफ देयर एनी अदर क्वेश्चंस व्हेन यू गो थ्रू द बुक, यू कैन ऑलवेज लेट मी नो एंड आई विल आंसर देम. थैंक यू.